الحمد لله الذي هدى عباده إلى طريق الهداية وفتح الأبواب فأرسل رسلا وأنبياء مبشرين ومنذرين أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم فاعتبروا يا أولي الأبصار صدق الله العلي العظيم. My respected elders, my brothers and young ones, and those listening at home, I greet you with the greeting of Islam. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Hopefully, in this 1 hour, we want to explore some of the verses of Surah An-Najm, the chapter on the star, and derive the lessons and try and understand the message Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is trying to relate to us. This surah is known as Najm, the star. It's Makkiya. It was revealed before the migration of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from Makkah to Medina. This surah is the first surah in which there is a verse upon which a sajda is required. Also, it's the first surah Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam publicly recited before the assembly of Quraysh. In the first 5 years of prophethood, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would meet individuals privately and he would summon and recite the Quran in private assemblies and private gatherings. It was on one occasion that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam proceeded to the Kaaba and he saw an assembly of Quraysh and he began saying the couplets of this surah. And Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam recited these verses to an assembly of Muslims and non-Muslims. They were touched, they were mesmerized. And after the completion of this surah, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam fell into prostration. Not only did the Muslims, even the mushrikeen all fell into prostration. Because they were captivated by the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It was only later on they regret, they had remorse. But on reciting this surah, all of them had to acknowledge that this beautiful kalam and speech was not from a madman, was not from a human being, was not forged, but must be divine. The theme of this surah is that it warns the disbelievers to change their attitude to Quran and Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It contains three principles. Firstly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses the people of Makkah and the Quraysh that your approach, your religion, the way of your forefathers is based on invented ideas, the goal of which is the dunya and not the akhirah. The goal and the ambition of which is this dunya and the material gain of the world and not the eternal akhirah. And a true religion is that which paves the way, which leads a person, which guides a person to that which is of the success of the akhirah. Secondly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala proves He's sovereign over the universe. There is haq and batil. The people who are righteous, the people who have been guided, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will open the gates of paradise to them. As for those who followed the batil and the falsehood, those who denied the verses of Allah, then for them they will be deprived of entry into Jannah. However, Allah says the door of repentance will forever be open to them as long as they repent before their death. And thirdly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructs man to study the events and the accounts of the previous nations and the message conveyed by the previous prophets, that this message of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not new. It was the same message followed by the previous prophets too. But the people of the prophets denied them, rejected them, then the punishment of Allah came unto them. O Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, if you neglect my verses, if you neglect in belief in me, so will the punishment will also come upon you. So the Akhirah is coming. The Akhirah is close. The Akhirah is few steps away. change your attitude, bow down to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are all driven by goals and objectives, whether it be a single lesson at school, at university, whether it be a young child who goes to a school, or a child who goes to the secondary school, or college or university, or a person who runs his own business, or a person who works under someone. We are all motivated by goals and ambitions. We all have targets. If we achieve these targets, we are successful. If we fail to achieve, then we are unsuccessful. Whether it may be in education or business and employment. So Allah says, your goal, your ambition, your objective should be the akhirah. What is the purpose of the dunya? The purpose is you are able to respond to the angels when you're lowered in the grave. The purpose is when the good deeds are weighed with your bad deeds, then the good deeds outweigh the bad deeds. The purpose is you please Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Your purpose is that you draw close to Allah. Your purpose is فَمَنْ زُحْزِهَ عَنِ النَّارِ وَأُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةِ فَقَدْ فَازْ. Who is successful? Allah says, one who has been protected from entering to hellfire, one for whom the gates of Jannah are open, he is successful. So we've been shared the goals, the objectives, the aims. Now are we fulfilling them? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing the people of Quraysh that we send the Quran, the divine message for your guidance, and we send Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he does not utter but from wahi and inspiration. As Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called them to the oneness of Allah, they accuse him of being a kahin, a fortune teller. They accuse him of being a sha'ir, a poet. They accuse him of being a sahir, a magician. They accuse him of being a majnoon, a madman. They hurled insults at Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was a mountain of steadfastness. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
والنجم إذا هوى ما ضل صاحبكم وما غوى وما ينطق عن الهوى إن هو إلا وحي يوحى.
والنجم, Allah takes the oath by the star. والنجم إذا هوى, that by the star when it sets. So Allah takes an oath, a qasam of the star, sitara, and he says when it sets, مَا ضَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ مَمَا غَوَى, that your companion, tumhara sati, your friend, مَا ضَلَّ, has not deviated, وَمَا غَوَى, nor has he lost his way. ضَلَّ, one who has adopted the wrong way unknowingly, and غَوَى is the one who adopts the wrong way knowingly. So neither has the Prophet adopted the wrong way unknowingly nor purposefully. So Allah takes an oath of a najm. Now why does Allah take an oath of a star? So Allah swears an oath by the star to emphasize the prophethood, the risalat, and the divine wahi. Why? Because just as the stars serve to guide people by night, in the same way the prophets and the wahi guide people who have wandered astray. They come as an inspiration, a lantern in the world of darkness. So the people look up to the skies and they are guided by the stars to their destination. People look at the ways of the Prophet. People look at the divine inspiration of the Quran and find their ways to the pleasure of Allah and paradise. Also, when the stars set and the day has dawned, everything becomes apparent for man in its real form and shape. Likewise, O people, the characteristics of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are not hidden in darkness. They are clear to you like the bright dawn. Allah chooses the word sahibukum, tumhara sati, your companion. So here Allah does not say Muhammad, our prophet, our messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has not gone astray. He says tumhara sati, he's your companion. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam always believed in one Allah, and they had no issues. When he practiced his faith, they had no issues. The moment he addressed them, the moment he told them the path of righteousness, then they accused him of forsaking the creed of their forefathers, that Muhammad is a kahin, he's a majnoon, he's a sahib, and he has lost his way. So Allah refutes them that the Prophet ma dalla has not deviated. He's your sati, he's your companion. It was unreasonable of Quraysh to falsify Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? They knew him when he was born. They knew him in his childhood. They knew him when he was a teenager. They knew him as a businessman. They knew him as a married man. They knew him as a father. They knew him when he was a 40-year-old man. So you knew him. They knew him as Amin, the trustworthy. They knew him as a Sadiq, the truthful. He would never lie to a soul. He would never forge or lie unto someone. He would never break a promise. So how was it that he would forge a lie unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? So he's your sahib. You are aware of it. How can he be kahin? Has he ever lied to you? Has he broke promises with you? Has he ever been suffering from any ill effect? He is the best role model amongst you. So ma dalla sahibukum wa ma ghawa. Allah then says, wa ma yantiku anil hawa. The Prophet talks of the hereafter. The Prophet talks of the ghaib, of the unseen. He does not speak out of his own whims. These are not his desires. They assume that they are his thoughts and feelings. He's suffering from an illness. He's majnoon, he's mad. وَمَا يَنْتِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَىٰ. It is not but wahi, inspiration revealed unto him. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَىٰ ذُو مِرَّةٍ فَاسْتَوَىٰ وَهُوَ بِالْرُفُقِ الْأَعْلَىٰ ثُمَّ دَنَا فَتَدَلَّىٰ فَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنِ أَوْ أَدَنَىٰ فَأَوْحَىٰ إِلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ مَا أَوْحَىٰ. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw Jibreel twice in his original form. So Allah says, أَلَّمَهُ شَدِيدُ الْقُوَىٰ, that Allah sent the divine message through the medium of Jibreel. So he has been taught by Shadidul Quwa, the one of immense might. This is the description of Jibreel alayhi salam. Shadidul Quwa, one of immense might. Dhu Mirra. Mirra has multiple meanings. One is strong, one who is wise, one who is grand, one who is healthy, one who is learned. Generally, it's translated as Dhu Mirra, one who is physically and intellectually powerful. So Allah describes Jibreel alayhi salam. Then Allah says, فَاسْتَوَىٰ. Jibreel appeared in his original form. وَهُوَ بِالْأُفُقِ الْأَعْلَىٰ, when he was on the highest part of the horizon of the sky. ثُمَّ دَنَىٰ, then Jibreel approached. فَتَدَلَّىٰ, he came close. فَكَانَ قَابَ قَوْسَيْنِ أَوْ أَدْنَىٰ, and Jibreel alayhi salam was as close as two bowls to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Allah says, أَوْ أَدْنَىٰ, or even closer. فَأَوْحَىٰ إِلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ مَا أَوْحَىٰ, and Allah inspired to his servant Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, which he inspired. So here, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam requested to see Jibreel Amin in his original form. So Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam saw Jibreel alayhi salam in the cave of Hira, and secondly in Ajyad in Mecca. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Jibreel Amin, and Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam requested to see him in his original form. So Jibreel appeared on the al-ufuq al-a'la, the eastern horizon, with 600 wings spread out. Upon looking at the scene, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam fell unconscious onto the ground. Jibreel appeared in the human form. Jibreel alayhi salam would come with inspiration to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Sometimes, okay, he would come in the human form, sometimes in his original form, sometimes he would instill the wahi and inspiration in the heart of Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. So here, Jibreel appeared in the human form, and he wiped the dust from the head of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Hence it says, ثُمَّ دَنَا فَتَدَلَّىٰ. Jibreel appeared in the human form. فَتَدَلَّىٰ, he came closer to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he was as close as two bows. Now it was an Arab custom, when they entered into an agreement and pact, they would hold the strings of their bows, of their bows, so close to each other that they would be touching each other. This would demonstrate their unity, their closeness, and their agreement and promise to be one. So here, Jibreel Amin appeared to be close to Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Why? To inspire to him the words that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had sent him with. Then Allah says, not only this, aw adna, even closer. Not only was he close physically, but also spiritually, because he inspired to him the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then Allah says, فَأَوْحَى إِلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ مَا أَوْحَى. Allah inspired to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that which he inspired. Some people say it's the words that none shall enter into Jannah until Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not enter. And no ummah will enter into paradise until the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam enters. And some say, فَوْحَى إِلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ مَا أَوْحَى. Ma, it refers to all that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala inspired. So Allah uses the word ma and keeps it generic and open. Why? To show the ta'zeem, the honor of the Quran, that no words can demonstrate and truly describe the wahi and the inspiration. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, so here Jibreel is called Dhu Mirra, the most powerful. Why? Because he's so powerful that no creation can overpower him. Hence no one can think that a devil has come and stolen, or that Jibreel was dishonest in his conveying of the message. Unfortunately, there were those from amongst the people of the book Allah talks about, those who said ill words of Jibreel. Some assumed that the shaitan had instilled words. Some assumed that some had been forgotten or misplaced. Allah says he is the most powerful one from the creation, that he has not been misled, and know that he has been dishonest in the words he has conveyed to Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. مَا كَذَبَ الْفُؤَادُ مَا رَآَى أَفَتُمَارُونَهُ عَلَى مَا يَرَى وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ نَزْلَةً أُخْرَى عِنْدَ سِدْرَةِ الْمُنْتَهَى عِنْدَهَا جَنَّةُ الْمَأْوَى إِذْ يَغْشَى السِّدْرَةَ مَا يَغْشَى مَا زَاغَ الْبَصَرُ وَمَا طَغَى لَقَدْ رَآ مِنْ آيَاتِ رَبِّهِ الْكُبْرَى.
Allah says, Al-Fu'ad. Fu'ad is the heart. The heart of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam does not mistake what it sees. He verily saw Jibreel in his original form. أَفَتُمَارُونَهُ عَلَىٰ مَا يَرَىٰ. Are you disputing with him in which what he saw? He has been inspired by wahi. He has been taught by Allah. For him, Allah has opened the veil of the unseen, which is hidden from us. Can the blind and the one who can see be similar? He is from amongst those who have been inspired by Allah. أَفَتُمَارُونَهُ عَلَىٰ مَا يَرَىٰ. Do you dispute in matters of the unseen? It is unfortunate now that we compare our religious beliefs with our rational thinking, with our logic. How can we use our rational thinking and logic and dispute the words of Allah, when the words of Allah are based on the ghayb? The wahi and the inspiration comes where our thinking stops. So أَفَتُمَارُونَهُ عَلَىٰ مَا يَرَىٰ وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ نَزْلَةً أُخْرَىٰ. And Allah discusses the second sighting. وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ النَّبِيَ كَرِيمُ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. So Jibreel, نَزْلَةً أُخْرَىٰ, once more. When did he see him? Allah says, عِنْدَ سِدْرَةِ الْمُنْتَهَىٰ, at the Sidratul Muntaha. The question arises, what is Sidratul Muntaha? Sidratul Muntaha is a lotus tree at which everything stops. Whatever deeds ascend to the heavens first stop there and only then continue. Similarly, whatever command of Allah descends onto the earth, it stops there and thereafter it descends. At Mi'raj, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was caused to travel from Makkah al-Mukarramah to Jerusalem. Allah says, Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-haram ila al-masjid al-aqsa alladhi barakna hawla, the surroundings of which we have blessed. So Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam chest was split, his Mubarak and the blessed heart was taken out, it was washed with zamzam, with prophethood, with wisdom, with love and the ma'rifat of Allah. It was placed back and he was allowed to travel on Buraq all the way from Makkah al-Mukarramah to Jerusalem, Masjid al-Aqsa. From there he met the souls of the prophets. He led them in prayer. And then he ascended into the heavens. The first, the second, the third, the fourth, the fifth, the sixth. There in the first he met Adam alayhi salam. Then he met Isa alayhi salam and Yahya alayhi salam. Then he met Idris alayhi salam. He also met Harun alayhi salam. He met Musa alayhi salam. Then he met Ibrahim alayhi salam. And after meeting Ibrahim alayhi salam, Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam proceeded to Sidratul Muntaha. Sidratul Muntaha is a lotus tree, the fruits of which are large than the water jugs of Hijr, and the leaves of which are larger than the ears of an elephant. And it's been encircled by beautiful golden butterflies, and it's enshrouded by magnificent colors that no beauty can ever describe. Hence Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala then says, Indaha Jannatul Ma'wa, close to which is Jannatul Ma'wa, the paradise, the place of residence, Idh Yaghsha Sidrata Ma Yaghsha, which is covered with that which covers it. So Allah uses a very vague term, Ma, which covers it, which covers it. Because Allah allows our mind to think, Ma, no beauty, no magnificence can ever compare. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam amazingly says that Allah says, أَعْبَدْتُ لِعِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحِينَ مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ. I have prepared for my righteous servants مَا لَا عَيْنٌ رَأَتْ, that which no eyes have ever seen, وَلَا أُذُنٌ سَمِعَتْ, that which no ears have ever heard of, وَلَا خَطَرَ عَلَى قَلْبِ بَشَرٍ, that the thought of which has never passed human's mind and heart. So Allah says, إِذْ يَغْشَى السِّدْرَةَ مَا يَغْشَى, it has been enshrouded by complete beauty, جَنَّةُ الْمَأْوَى, the Jannah of Ma'wa. What is Jannah of Ma'wa? Either it's a paradise in which the muttaqeen, the righteous people will stay in, or it is where the souls of the shuhada and the martyrs are, or it's a paradise where Adam alayhi salam is, or where the souls of the mu'minun are, or where Jibreel and Mikael are residing. Allah then says, مَا زَاغَ الْبَصَرُ وَمَا تَغَى, his sight neither wavered nor transgressed. Imagine entering into a beautiful courtyard. Imagine entering in a beautiful palace and you see the beauty and the grandeur and the magnificence, and your gazes are fixed. Neither do they move right or left. Allah says, مَا زَاغَ الْبَصَرُ وَمَا تَغَى, it was so beautiful when he saw in front of him, his gaze were fixed. They didn't turn right or left. It didn't fall on anything else. Therefore, he could accurately recount everything he saw. مَا زَاغَ الْبَصَرُ وَمَا تَغَى. And he spoke to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hence, when man stands before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in prayer, when man recites the Quran, his sight should not waver or transgress anywhere. Should not be to the right or left. His tawajjuh, his focus, his concentration should be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The moment our gaze is for right or left, then our minds will start to wander. Hence, alhamdulillah, when we go in the path of Allah in jama'ah, in tabligh, when people go in groups, in gasht, the Amir and the Mutakallim will appoint the people and tell the people to keep their gazes low, to maintain focus, not to allow the gazes to fall here and there. Otherwise, the temptations, the luxuries, the wonder of the world will instill in the heart, which will affect the spirituality, the concern, the fikr with which man has proceeded. Hence, we should be focused in akhirah, in our righteous ways. However, if our gazes, if our focus, if our temptation moves otherwise, then it will wander off from our purpose, our objective, our aim, which was the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. لَقَدْ رَآ مِنْ آيَاتِ رَبِّهِ الْكُبْرَى, verily he saw some of the great signs. Now a question arises. There are difference of opinions. What did Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam see? There is one opinion of some of the companions that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam saw Allah. There is a second opinion of some of the other companions that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not see Allah. لا تدركه الأبصار وهو يدرك الأبصار. لا تدركه الأبصار. The gazes of mankind cannot envisage and encompass Allah. He is beyond our vision, but He encompasses everyone. So it says here, he saw some of the great signs. So he did not see Allah, but he saw the great sign, Jibreel. The third opinion is that there is no comment to confirm or to deny that Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw Allah or not. Therefore, the safest position is that we do not say with certainty that he saw Allah or he did not. And neither does it affect our belief. Ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu says that the great sign here is Jibreel, when he saw him in his original form again with 600 wings at Sidratul Muntaha. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ اللَّاتَ وَالْعُزَّى وَمَنَاةَ الثَّالِثَةَ الْأُخْرَى أَلَكُمُ الذَّكَرُ وَلَهُ الْأُنْثَى تِلْكَ إِذًا قِسْمَةٌ ضِيزَى إِنْ هِيَ إِلَّا أَسْمَاءٌ سَمَّيْتُمُوهَا أَنْتُمْ وَآبَاؤُكُمْ مَا أَنْزَلَ اللَّهُ بِهَا مِنْ سُلْطَانٍ إِنْ يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنَّ وَمَا تَهْوَى الْأَنْفُسُ وَلَقَدْ جَاءَهُمْ مِنْ رَبِّهِمُ الْهُدَى أَمْ لِلْإِنْسَانِ مَا تَمَنَّى فَلِلَّهِ الْآخِرَةُ وَالْأُولَى. Allah says, أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ اللَّاتَ وَالْعُزَّى. Have you seen Lat and Uzza? وَمَنَاتَ الثَّالِثَةُ الْأُخْرَى. And the third one, Manat. Not only mushrikeen foolishly enough ascribe children to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they ascribe daughters which they themselves regarded as disgraceful. So Allah says, have you seen Lat and Uzza and Manat, whom you bow your heads to? أَلَكُمُ الذَّكَرُ وَلَهُ الْأُنْثَى. And they used to say that the angels of the Banat of Allah, the angels are the daughters of Allah. Allah says, أَلَكُمُ الذَّكَرُ. Are males for you, وَلَهُ الْأُنْثَى, and females for Allah. In another verse, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَيَجْعَلُونَ لِلَّهِ الْبَنَاتِ سُبْحَانَهُ وَلَهُمْ مَا يَشْتَهُونَ وَإِذَا بُشِّرَ أَحَدُهُمْ بِالْأُنْثَى ظَلَّ وَجْهُهُ مُسْوَدًّا وَهُوَ كَظِيمٌ يَتَوَارَى مِنَ الْقَوْمِ مِنْ سُوءِ مَا بُشِّرَ بِهِ أَيُمْسِكُهُ عَلَى هُونٍ أَمْ يَدُسُّهُ فِي التُّرَابِ أَلَا سَاءَ مَا يَحْكُمُونَ. Allah says in the 14th juz of the Quran that do they assign angels as the daughters of Allah? Subhana, uski dhaat paak hai, Allah is pure. Yet they have for themselves what they desire. They desire children, they desire sons, and they feel that it's humiliation to have a young daughter. Allah then says, when any one of them was, Allah says, bushira, the birth of a girl in the home is a mercy of Allah. So Allah says, bushira, jab unhe khush khabri di jati hai, when they are given the glad tidings of the daughter, what happens to them? Dhalla wajhu muswadda, their face turns darkened, and they suppress their anger, and they hide from people. You ruswaye, there's disgrace and humiliation. Why? Because of the tidings that they've received. Then Allah says, why? Because they are thinking that should they keep that young daughter with disgrace and humiliation in society? أَمْ يَدُسُّهُ فِي التُّرَابِ. Or should he bury her in the sand? Allah says, وَإِذَا الْمَوْءُودَةُ سُئِلَتْ. The innocent children, the girls they used to bury in the sand alive, they will be summoned on the day of judgment. That, oh daughter, oh young innocent baby, what crime did you commit it to be buried alive? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the deen which gave and afforded the rights of Muslims, and gave the afford and afforded the right of the animals, the humans, and even the daughters, that this girl is a daughter, this girl is a sister, this girl is a mother, and Jannah, paradise, lies under her feet. This girl is a daughter, and if you nourish her, look after her, provide her with the education, then Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that Allah will enter you into paradise. So Allah says, are males for you and for Allah is females. Tilka idan qismatun diza. This is an unjust distribution. Lat, Uzza, Manat. These idols whom you worship, They are not but names which you and your forefathers have invented. And Allah has not revealed any sultan, any dalil, any evidence, any warrant. But then Allah says, إِيَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنِ. They do not follow but assumptions, khayalat, wahm, guman, وَمَا تَهْوَى الْأَنفُسِ, and what their whims fancy. It is as Arabs attach great importance to these idols. Allah mentioned the Lat, Uzza, Manat. And after Prophet ﷺ conquered Makkah, he sent the companions to destroy. And they assumed that these idols had the power to benefit the people. So Allah's Messenger ﷺ commanded his companions to break them and to prove to the people neither do they harm nor do they allow benefit to anyone. They assumed that they fulfill our worldly things. And secondly, they denied Akhirat. But if there is Akhirah, they assumed that these angels would intercede on behalf of them. Allah says, they do not follow but assumptions. Secondly, what their whims fancy they do. So the basic causes of a person's gumrahi and deviation is two. Firstly, that a person does not yearn to seek the knowledge of reality. And secondly, fulfilling one's desires. Hence, we also suffer from these things. إِيَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنِ. Allah says, acquire true knowledge, acquire the knowledge of deen, and suppress the nafs. Otherwise, if you are in the pursuit of seeking any other sciences other than deen, and if a person does not want to be restricted, he finds the deen very restricting. Many times a person finds deen very restricting. So Allah says, have you seen the one who has made his desires into his God? When deen is very easy, imagine we have 24 hours in a day. The salah 5 times a day, maximum 2 hours. Allah says 2 hours for me, 22 hours for you. Fasting, Allah says 1 month for me, 11 months for you. Zakat, Allah says 2.5% for me, 97.5% for you. Hajj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says once in a lifetime, the remaining 40, 50, 60 years for you. So the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is easy. But Allah says, إِيَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنِ. When people fall in acquiring the knowledge of that which is not the divine knowledge, and when they fall prey to their nafs, this is the recipe of their misguidance. Allah says, وَلَقَدْ جَاءَهُمْ مِنْ رَبِّهِمُ الْهُدَىٰ. Whereas has come to them from their Lord al-huda, hidayat. This is either the Prophet or the Quran. أَمْ لِلْإِنسَانِ مَا تَمَنَّىٰ. Should man have whatever he wishes? Oh insan, you want to commit zina, would we allow that? You want to take intoxicants and drugs, will we allow? You want to take interest, will we allow that? You want to fulfill your desires, will we allow that? أَمْ لِلْإِنسَانِ مَا تَمَنَّىٰ. Should man have whatever he wishes for? Then what has he sacrificed for the Akhirah then? If you have everything in the world, if you fulfill all your desires in the world, what have we left for the hereafter? فَلِلَّهِ الْآخِرَةُ وَالْأُولَىٰ. No other than Allah, nothing can benefit you. Why? For Allah belongs to Al-Akhirah wal-Ula, this world and the hereafter, the first and the last, everything. وَلِلَّهِ خَزَائِنُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. The treasures of the world are in the possession of Allah. You run and you chase the dunya, the world, but who does it belong to? Who does the Akhirah belong to? No Manat, no Uzza, no job, no money, no reputation. But it is my and your Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's pleasure that we should be seeking. Allah then says,
وَكَمْ مِنْ مَلَكٍ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ لَا تُغْنِي شَفَاعَتُهُمْ شَيْئًا إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ أَنْ يَأْذَنَ اللَّهُ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ وَيَرْضَى.
As we said, the mushrikeen believe that their idols benefit them or remove any harm from them. And if there was an Akhirah, they assumed that the angels or these idols would intercede on behalf of them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala refutes those individuals. And Allah says, وَكَمْ مِنْ مَلَكٍ فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ. Many angels in the samawat, in the heavens, لَا تُغْنِي شَفَاعَتُهُمْ شَيْئًا, whose intercession shall be of no avail, إِلَّا مِنْ بَعْدِ أَنْ يَأْذَنَ اللَّهِ, but after Allah grants permission, لِمَنْ يَشَاء, for whomsoever he wishes, وَيَرْضَىٰ, and is pleased with. Allah will allow not the mushrikeen and the disbelievers to intercede, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will allow his righteous persons Allah says, لِمَنْ يَشَاءَ, for whomsoever He wishes, Allah will allow the righteous people to intercede on behalf of each other. Hence, in a beautiful hadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam says that one who recites the Quran, man qara'a al-Quran, fastadharahu, and he memorizes the Quran, fa'ahalla halalahu wa harrama haramahu, makes lawful unto him which Allah has made lawful, prohibits upon him that which Allah has made prohibited upon him, what will Allah do? Adkhalahu Allahu al-Jannah, Allah will enter him into paradise. Wa shafa'ahu fi 'ashratin min ahli baytihi kullim qad wajabat lahu an-nar, and Allah will say to the hafiz, Allah will say to him, go intercede on behalf of 10 members of your family for whom it was destined that they will be doomed in Jahannam. So Allah will allow these righteous persons to intercede. But Allah says, for the mushrikeen and for the disbelievers, those who denied Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's existence and the belief in Allah and the oneness of Allah will not be given intercession. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَقَالُوا اتَّخَذَ الرَّحْمَنُ وَلَدًا سُبْحَانَهُ بَلْ عِبَادٌ مُكْرَمُونَ لَا يَسْبِقُونَهُ بِالْقَوْلِ وَهُمْ بِأَمْرِهِ يَعْمَلُونَ يَعْلَمُ مَا بَيْنَ أَيْدِيهِمْ وَمَا خَلْفَهُمْ وَلَا يَشْفَعُونَ إِلَّا لِمَنِ ارْتَضَى وَهُمْ مِنْ خَشْيَتِهِ مُشْفِقُونَ.
They used to assume that Ar-Rahman, the most merciful, has na'udh billah son. Like they said that Uzair ibn Allah, Uzair is the son of Allah. Some of them said Isa alayhi salam is the son of Allah. They said the angels were the banat, was the daughters of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah says, Subhana is pure. The angels are not but honorable slaves of Allah. They do not speak ahead of Allah. Their task is to carry out all that which Allah has ordained them. He knows that which is before them. He knows that which is behind them. They do as Allah is pleased with. And they will only be able to intercede upon the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the angels tremble out of the fear of Allah. They themselves have no power but the power which Allah has given them. Then Allah says,
إِنَّ الَّذِينَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ بِالْآخِرَةِ لَيُسَمُّونَ الْمَلَائِكَةَ تَسْمِيَةَ الْأُنْثَى وَمَا لَهُمْ بِهِ مِنْ عِلْمٍ إِنْ يَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنَّ وَإِنَّ الظَّنَّ لَا يُغْنِي مِنَ الْحَقِّ شَيْئًا.
Verily those who do not believe in the Akhirah, they claim that the Malaika, the angels, were the daughters of Allah. Allah says, وَمَا لَهُمْ بِهِ مِنْ عِلْمٍ, without possessing any knowledge of it. إِيَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنَّ, they do not follow but then wahan, guman, assumptions. وَإِنَّ الظَّنَّ لَا يُغْنِي مِنَ الْحَقِّ شَيْئًا, and verily assumptions are useless against the haq. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, one of the reasons of ma'asiyah, guna, kufr, disbelief, shirk and steadfastness on it is lack of belief in the akhirah. A person who increases in the belief in akhirah will increase in humility before Allah. Imagine at a workplace, if he knows there's accountability, if he knows there's a reckoning, if he knows there is an exam at the end, if he knows there's a reckoning before the employer, if he knows at the end of the year, the business will be looked at, my activities will be assessed, then he will be conscious. So as long as his gaze is fixed to the objective, the goals, the ending, he will remain. So the person who has the consciousness of the Akhirah, he knows my Allah will summon me, he knows Allah will reckon me, he knows the Jannat and Jahannam is there, and therefore each and every moment of his life will be spent as conscious of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But one who does not believe in the Akhirah, Allah says, one who does not believe in the Akhirah will do as he like. One whose belief it lacks and is weak will assume that they will be from amongst the people who will intercede. The mushrikeen assume that the angels would intercede. Also the Yahud, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, assumed لَمْ تَمَسَّنَ النَّارُ إِلَّا أَيَّامًا مَعْدُودًا, that the fire will not touch us for a few days, and therefore they became courageous on doing sins. The Nasara, they assumed that their leaders would forgive their sin, the original sin, and they became relaxed. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, increase in your belief in the Akhirah and that will help you to stay steadfast. So save yourself from the punishment in the Akhirah. If man believes in reckoning in Akhirah, he will not find rest. He will not be able to find taste in food until he finds deen and the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the three things take a person to Jahannam. Firstly is the weak belief in Akhirah. Weak belief in Akhirah. Secondly, as we said, following وَمَا تَهْوَى الْأَنْفُسِ, following whims and desires. And thirdly, fabricating the deen on personal speculation. So Allah says that guman and assumptions are useless against the truth. This verse is a lesson for those who picture their logic and rational against the clear statements of the Quran and Hadith. Many think evil of people, which also leads to backbiting and slandering. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِيَّاكُمْ وَظَّنْ, stay away from suspicion, accusation, assumptions. Why? فَإِنَّ الظَّنَّ أَكْذَبُ الْحَدِيثِ, it is the worst lie. وَلَا تَحَسَّسُوا وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا وَلَا تَحَاسَدُوا وَلَا تَدَابَرُوا وَلَا تَبَاغَذُوا وَكُونَ عِبَادَ اللَّهِ إِخْوَانَا. Do not look for faults in each other. Do not spy on each other. Do not cut off relations from each other. Do not be jealous of each other. Do not harbor any hatred. But live as the servants of Allah. Live as brothers unto one. Allah says, فَأَعْرِضْ عَمَّنْ تَوَلَّى عَنْ ذِكْرِنَا وَلَمْ يُرِدْ إِلَّا الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا ذَلِكَ مَبَلَغُهُمْ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنْ ضَلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِهِ وَهُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اهْتَدَى. This is absolutely amazing. Allah says, فَأَعْرِضْ, ignore him who turns away from our remembrance and the desires, and he desires only the life of this world. Don't be grieved by his evil ways. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam is being told, ignore the person who turns away from our Quran, from our advice, and his mission, his desires is the al-hayat ad-dunya, this world. Allah says, ذَلِكَ مَبْلَغُهُمْ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ, this is the extent of their knowledge. Verily your Lord knows best, one who has deviated from his path and one who is on the righteous path. So, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, your duty is simply to convey this man, all aspects of whose life revolve around this world. He earns to live and he lives to earn. فَأَعْرِضْ, ignore him and turn away from him. Their purpose in life is simply to gain the material world. Their energies, their thought, their thinking is everything for the dunya. They have superficial knowledge of the akhirah, they are negligent of the akhirah. They have love and deep insight and interest in the world. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, the love of the dunya will damage your akhirah. The love for this dunya is the source of all sins. Yes, this dunya we all have to live. Everyone has to embark on the ship. We must cross the sea and reach the other end. But do not allow the water to enter into our ship. Because the moment we allow the water, the sea water to enter into the ship, we will all drown. When you allow the hub and the love of the dunya to enter into the heart, the person drowns in the ship, in ma'asiyah, in guna, in kufr, in shirk, in negligence. Hence Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam used to make dua, Allahumma la taj'al musibatana fi deenina, ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا غاية رغبتنا. Oh Allah, do not place difficulties in our deen. Make our deen easy for us. And don't make dunya the greatest concern and the extent of our knowledge. So Allah says, one for whom he lives for the dunya. It is unfortunate when a young child is born from a young age, 3, 4, 5 years, 8, 9 hours are spent in education other than that of the divine. Then he enters into secondary school, goes college, university. A great portion of the day in his in pursuit, مَبْلَغُهُمْ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ. Allah says the extent of the knowledge is dunya. You acquire the source. Why? He has to sit the GCSEs. Then he progresses, he has to receive the best A-levels. Then he progresses, he needs to achieve the best marks at his degree. Then he has to pursue and receive a master's PhD. Then he has to find a suitable work. Then he is trained at workplace. Then he has to advance. Then he wants to climb and become more successful than he was. When he reaches 40 and 50, 60, and all his life, ذَلِكَ مَبَلَغُهُمْ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ, the extent, the purpose of his knowledge has become this dunya. Let's assess ourselves. We gave from a young age of 4, 5, 8 hours to the dunya, the extent of the knowledge of the dunya. At school, at college, at universities in dunya, how much have we given to the akhirah? How much have we increased in our knowledge? A madrasa curriculum starts at the age of 4, 5, 2 hours, 2.5 hours a day, until the age of 13, 14, 15, 16. That's the extent of our knowledge. Whilst the knowledge of the akhirah continues. We do not say over here, do not excel in the world. Yes, be the scientist. Yes, study law, study pharmacy, study different various sciences, excel in them, be the best in them, but be a Muslim. Be a Muslim doctor, be a Muslim lawyer, be a Muslim plumber, be a Muslim profession. Stand for your values, your purpose, the mablagh, your objective should be akhirah, should be to increase in the knowledge of the akhirah. You should not be from amongst وَلَمْ يُرِدْ إِلَّا الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا, that their desire is only in the dunya. They live their lives only in the pursuit of dunya. We wake up early in the morning. We prepare our children to go to school. Early morning they go 8 o'clock perhaps or 9 o'clock at the least. They return home at 3, 4 o'clock. And in the weekends, continuing their homeworks and other leisures and activities. We also leave the home at 8, 9 o'clock. We work until 3, 4, 5 o'clock. Is this the dunya we want to pursue? وَلَمْ يُرِدْ إِلَّا الْحَيَاةَ الدُّنْيَا ذَلِكَ مَبْلَغُ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ. Is this the extent of our aspirations? Is this the only thing we want? University and degree? Is this the only thing, the best job? Money, fame, reputation? Or is there anything beyond that? Is there an akhirah after that? Is there an unseen beyond that? Allah says, ذَلِكَ مَبْلَغُ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ. إِنَّ رَبَّكَ وَعَلَمَ بِمَنْ دَلَّ عَنْ سَبِيلِ. Invest in your faith, invest in your knowledge, invest in righteousness, invest in the deen of your children. Allah knows well. But those who are deviated, Allah also knows them. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, here provides ذَلَّ أَنْ اِهْتَدَى. ذَلَّ, one who is misguided, اِهْتَدَى, one who is righteous. This is known as a tibaq. Allah provides a juxtaposition to show that one who is dalla, who has led astray, his pathway is Jahannam. One who is rightly guided, his pathway into Jannah. They're very different. You may see and ponder upon where you want to lie. The way you live your life, the death will approach you. And the way the death comes to you, that's how you'll be resurrected. And the Jannat and Jahannam will be the option given. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَلِلَّهِ مَا فِي السَّمَاوَاتِ وَمَا فِي الْأَرْضِ, that for Allah belongs everything in the heavens and the earth. لِيَجْزِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسَاءُوا بِمَا عَمِلُوا وَيَجْزِيَ الَّذِينَ أَحْسَنُوا بِالْحُسْنَى. There are two groups from amongst the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There were those, لِيَجْزِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسَاءُوا بِمَا عَمِلُوا, the evil doers whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish. And there are those who do Al-Husna, the best and the good, whom Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward. So Allah says, those who do good and those who stay away from fulfilling their desires, they will have perfect belief. Yes, الَّذِينَ يَجْتَنِبُونَ كَبَائِرَ الْإِثْمِ وَالْفَوَاحِشَ إِلَّا اللَّمَمْ. Allah says, who are the righteous people? Who are those whom Allah will reward? Those who stay away from the major sins and indecent acts, but minor sins. And verily, إِنَّ رَبَّكَ وَاسِعُ الْمَغْفِرَةِ. Your Lord is one of extensive mercy. As humans, we may commit sins, but the righteous servants of Allah are those who straight away repent from their sins. Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِيَّاكَ وَمُحَقَّرَاتِ الذُّنُومِ. Beware of seemingly insignificant sins. Never assume any sin to be small or minor. It may well be that minor sin will lead a person into Jahannam. But the sifat and the characteristic of the believers is that the moment they err and commit a sin, immediately they ask for forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. كُلُّ بَنِي آدَمَ خَطَّاءٌ. Every human is a sinner, but the best of sinners are those who repent immediately. Allah then says, do not lose hope. إِنَّ رَبَّكَ وَاسِعُ الْمَغْفِرَةِ Verily, He is one of extensive mercy. هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِكُمْ إِذْ أَنْشَأَكُمْ مِنَ الْأَرْضِ وَإِذْ أَنْتُمْ أَجِنَّةٌ فِي بُطُونِ أُمَّهَاتِكُمْ O insan, He knows, He is best aware of you when He created for you from mithya and the soil, and when you are fetus in the wombs of your mother. هَلْ أَتَىٰ عَلَى الْإِنسَانِ حِينٌ مِّنَ الدَّهْرِ لَمْ يَكُنْ شَيْئًا مَذْكُورًا You are not in existence, then you are a droplet of impure substance, seed. Then Allah gave rise to you in the womb. Allah knew the condition, no one else knew. فَلَا تُزَكُّوا أَنفُسَكُمْ Do not ascribe purity to yourself. Even if you do righteous good acts, no one is able to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as he should be. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, don't ascribe purity to yourself. Don't boast and praise yourself. Always have humility. Do righteous actions and keep hope and acceptance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? We may be proud of our ibadah. Moments before our death, we could be deprived of the kalima. But one who has lived his life of ma'asiyah and Allah accepts one good deed, and at the last moment Allah provides him with the opportunity to repent. Allah says, هُوَ أَعْلَمُ بِمَنِ اتَّقَى He knows best one who is the most pious. Then Allah says, أَفَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي تَوَلَّى وَأَعْطَى قَلِيلًا وَأَكْدَى أَعِيُدَهُ عِلْمُ الْغَيْبِ فَهُوَ يَرَى أَمْ لَمْ يُنَبَّأْ بِمَا فِي صُحُفِ مُوسَى وَإِبْرَاهِيمَ الَّذِي وَفَّى أَلَّا تَزِرْ وَازِرَةٌ وِزْرَ أُخْرَى وَأَنْ لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى ثُمَّ يُجْزَاهُ الْجَزَاءَ الْأَوْفَى وَأَنَّ إِلَى رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَى There was a man who was known as Walid bin Mughira. He was impressed by Quran and the words of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and he drew closer to Islam. So one of his associates and a mushrik teased him that, why are you being inclined to Islam? Why are you being inclined to the Quran and the words of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam? Do you fear the punishment? Do you fear akhirah? He said, yeah. So the mushrik said to him, his colleague, that are you going to forsake and abandon the way of your forefathers? Will you go against the cultural norms and our society because of this man? He said, well, I fear the punishment. He said, if you fear the punishment, then I take the assurance, I will bear your punishment in return for a price. So he agreed, and Walid bin Mughira started and began to pay the price. And after some moment, he stopped paying the price. But he did not accept Islam. Allah says, أَفَرَأَيْتَ الَّذِي تَوَلَّى Have you seen the one who turns away? وَأَعْتَى قَلِيلًا He gives a little. وَأَكْدَى Then he stops. He's a miser for his own success as he sees that I will be saved from the punishment if he pay the price. He is so miser that to save his own self, he gave money, then he restricts. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَأَعْطَى قَلِيلًا وَأَقْدَى He gave a little and he stops. And amazingly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in another verse says, الْأَخِلَّاءُ يَوْمَئِذٍ بَعْدُهُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُونَ إِلَى الْمُتَّقِينَ The best friends in this world will be the enemies in the hereafter. Because of their bad influence. We should not be influenced by the society, the workplace, cultural norms, home, friends, associates. Why? Because everyone is loading their grave separately. They'll be resurrected likewise, and everyone will have to give an account. Allah says, أَعِنْدَهُ عِلْمُ الْغَيْبِ فَهُوَ يَرَى Did he have the knowledge of the unseen which he can see with? He doesn't know whether he'll be allowed to bear the burden of another. Allah says, No soul shall bear the burden of another. How could this mushrik and his friend claim to bear the burden and his punishment? أَمْ لَمْ يُنَبَّأْ بِمَا فِي صُحُفِ مُوسَى وَإِبْرَاهِيمَ الَّذِي وَفَّى Has he not been informed in that which is in the scriptures of Musa and Ibrahim alayhi salam, who fulfilled everything? It was in their scriptures that every man is for himself. As Ibrahim fulfilled, what did Ibrahim alayhi salam fulfill? Some scholars say Ibrahim alayhi salam fulfilled all the tasks ordained by Allah. Some say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, Aslim, submit, and he immediately submitted to Allah. Some say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told him to slaughter his son, and he was willing to slaughter his son for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was the greatest at fulfilling his allegiance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Some said Ibrahim alayhi salam prevented the relative of a murderer to be killed on behalf of an actual murderer. So a murderer was killed for the killing that he had done so, but unjustly the relative of a murderer was being killed. Ibrahim alayhi salam protected the life of humanity. And also it says in a hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam that he would recite 4 rakats every morning ishraq. Allah says waffa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says read 4 rakats in early morning in the ishraq, and all your desires and all your tasks will be sufficient for you during the day. Allah tazir waziratu wizra ukhra, that one bearer shall not bear the burden of another. وَأَلْ لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى, man shall have only that which he strives. وَأَنَّ سَعْيَهُ سَوْفَ يُرَى, his efforts will soon be seen. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يُضِيعُ أَجْرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ, your efforts will never go to vain. Allah sees, Allah appreciates, Allah will reward you. So this is a wa'id and a threat for disbelievers that there is Jahannam, and there is a consequence to pay, the price to pay for sin. But O believers, this is the wada of Allah. You do good deed, you sow the seeds, and then you will see the fruits of it in Jannah. Now, there is a seemingly contradiction between two verses. Here it says that no one will bear the burden of another. وَأَلْ لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى, that man shall have only that which he strives. There is another verse which says that Allah gives increasing reward to those who whomsoever He wishes. The first explanation is that it is the iman, that the iman of a person will not benefit the iman, the lack of iman of another. So a person with iman will not be able to intercede on behalf of someone who did not have iman. Nuh alayhi salam lost his son, who left the world without iman. Ibrahim alayhi salam lost his father without iman. So no person of iman, their iman will benefit another. Secondly, some scholars say there are exceptions. For example, Hajj, Badal, Sadaqah, Quran, the rewards of which will receive the deceased, which is done on behalf of them. So if you have any marhumin, any deceased, although they have not performed the act, but if you give some charity, then Allah will allow the reward to go to them. If a person performs Hajj, Badal, recite some Quran to them. Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wasallam says in multiple ahadith, one of them is that إِذَا مَاتَ الْإِنسَانِ, when a human passes away, إِنْ قَطَعَ عَنْهُ عَمَلُهُ, then his a'mal, his actions come to a termination. But there are three which continue. Sadaqatin jariyah, a continuous charity. A person allows and gives some money in charity to build a well. As long as any soul, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, even a bird drinks from the water from the well, the person is being rewarded even in his grave. A person gives donates a Quran copy. Each time someone recites from it, his rewards are increasing. A person invests in a masjid, builds a masjid. Each time someone prostrates and prays to Allah in the masjid, he's being rewarded. Then Allah's Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam says, "Ilmin yuntafa'u bih." Any knowledge that you share with others and they practice, each time they fulfill the commandment of Allah, the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, though you may be lowered in the grave, you shall also receive. And then amazingly, waladin salih yatrukula, a righteous son that you invest in. If you invest in the deen ta'aleem, then even after your death, there will be a means of sadaqah, jariyah, continuous charity. This verse is revoked by Allah, says, وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَاتَّبَعَتْهُمْ ذُرِّيَّتُهُمْ بِإِيمَانِ أَلْحَقْنَا بِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَمَا أَلَتْنَاهُمْ مِنْ عَمَلِهِمْ مِنْ شَيْءٍ. Those who carry out good deeds and whose dhurriyat, jinki awlad, their progeny, follow them also in iman and righteous good deed, we shall join their progeny without reducing any deeds from them. So we will be able to enjoy our lives in paradise with our family members because of the iman and the amal. Some scholars say it only applies to sins, that we can benefit each other even after the death of one in good deeds, but the sin will not be upon the other. Some say it's a privilege of ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that even after the death, that the reward can be conveyed to them. And some scholars say over here, this is the adl of Allah, the justice of Allah, that you did this, therefore you will only get the reward of what you did. But the fadl of Allah, the grace of Allah, is that He will give you much more than you deserve. ثُمَّ يُجْزَاهُ الْجَزَاءَ الْأَوْفَى, after which he will be given retribution in full. وَإِنَّ إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَى, then your end is where? To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then who is Allah? Allah says, وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَضْحَكَ وَأَبَكَى وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَمَاتَ وَأَحْيَى وَأَنَّهُ خَلَقَ الزَّوْجَيْنِ الذَّكَرَ وَالْأُنْثَى مِنْ نُطَفَةٍ إِذَا تُمْنَى وَأَنَّ عَلَيْهِ النَّشْأَةَ الْأُخْرَى وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَغْنَى وَأَقْنَى وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ رَبُّ الشِّعْرَى وَأَنَّهُ أَهْلَكَ عَادًا الْأُولَى وَثَمُودَ فَمَا أَبْقَى وَقَوْمَ نُوحٍ مِنْ قَبْلُ إِنَّهُمْ كانوهم مظلم وأطغى والمؤتفكة أهوى فغشاها ما غشا. Who causes you to laugh? It is Allah. It is Allah who is the muntaha. Your end, your goal is who? Allah. The goal, the end of your seeking education should be the pleasure of Allah. Your striving should be the pleasure of Allah. The end goal of your ibadah should be the pleasure of Allah. Your interaction with others, the end goal is to the pleasure of Allah. Lastly, when you're lowered in the grave, who will you return to? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He causes you to laugh. Abaka, He causes you to cry. Huwa amata, He causes you to die. Wa ahya, He causes you to live. أَنَّهُ خَلَقَ الزَّوْجَيْنِ الذَّكَرَ وَالْأُنْثَى, it is He who created the pairs of male and female from a single seed when it issues forth. Allah created you when you were nothing. Allah says, وَأَنَّ عَلَيْهِمْ نَشْأَةَ الْأُخْرَى, the second creation is the responsibility of Allah. When you are lowered in the grave, the mushrikeen said, how will we be resurrected when we have turned into dust and ashes and bones and soil? وَأَنَّ عَلَيْهِمْ نَشْأَةَ الْأُخْرَى, it is the responsibility of Allah to resurrect you once again. وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ أَغْنَى وَأَقْنَى, who gives you wealth? Allah. Who afflicts you with poverty? Allah. Chase the dunya, it is like a shadow. The further you run away, it will chase you. The further you chase your own shadow, it will run away from you. Turn to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will make the dunya subservient to you. وَأَنَّهُ هُوَ رَبُّ الشِّعْرَى, shi'ra is the brightest star due to the closeness to the earth. And some of the Arabs worship this star. Allah is saying, هُوَ رَبُّ الشِّعْرَى, Allah is your creator. Allah is your sustainer. Allah will look after your needs. Allah is the creator of the heavens. Allah is the creator of the earth. Allah is the creator of the shi'ra, sun and the star. How can the shi'ra be your Lord? وَأَنَّهُ أَهْلَكَ عَادٍ أُولَى, take heed. Why? Because Hud alayhi salam's people did not take heed. Salih alayhi salam's people did not take heed. Lut alayhi salam's people did not take heed. Then came the wrath of Allah. Allah created, Allah destroyed the former Ad. And Allah destroyed the Thamud. فَمَا أَوْقَى فَمَا أَبْقَى, none of them remained. وَقَوْمَ نُوحٍ مِّن قَبْلِ, it was the people of Nuh whom Allah destroyed in floods before. إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا هُمْ أَظْلَمَ وَأَطْغَى, they were the most rebellious. So Allah destroys those who are all arrogant because of their disbelief. Allah says, وَالْمُؤْتَفِكَةَ أَهْوَى, He also threw down the overturned cities, the people of Lut alayhi salam. Allah lifted their ground to the skies, overturned them, tossed them down, and caused the stones to rain down upon them. Allah says, فَغَشَّاهَا مَا غَشَّى, so that covered them that which covered. Lastly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكَ تَتَمَارَى هَذَا نَذِيرٌ مِّنَ النُّذُرِ الْأُولَى أَزِفَتِ الْآزِفَةِ لَيْسَ لَهَا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ كَاشِفَةٌ أَفَمِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ تَعْجَبُونَ وَتَضْحَكُونَ وَلَا تَبْكُونَ وَأَنتُمْ سَامِدُونَ فَاسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ وَاعْبُدُوا. الله سبحانه وتعالى says that Allah destroyed them. Why? Because they doubted in their faith. So فَبِأَيِّ آلَاءِ رَبِّكَ, which bounties of your Lord will you doubt? Allah created you. Allah looked after you. Allah gave you the provisions. Allah will summon and reckon you. Which of the bounties of Allah do you doubt in? This nadir, this warner has come to you. مِنَ النُّذُرِ الْأُولَى, from the earlier warners. What is this nadir warner? Either it's the accounts of how the previous nations were destroyed. So if you do not take heed, Allah will also destroy you. Secondly, the Prophet has come to you. Or some say the Quran has come to you. The divine scripture is not new. It has come to you. Do not follow the footsteps upon whom Allah was angry, upon whom Allah wrath came. Why? Because as they neglected the call of the messenger and the divine call and they were destroyed, you also will be destroyed. Allah says, Azifatil Azifa. Don't be deluded. Don't assume. We've got lots of years left yet. No, take the moment. Change does not come from tomorrow. Change does not come from when we return home. Change comes from this very moment. Azifatil Azifa. Allah is talking about the Akhirat. The Sa'ah, Qiyamah, death. Azifatil Azifa. The swift, the quick approaching matter has already arrived. Allah says, Aagaye. Aapke maut ka waqt aa gaya hai, qiyamah aa gaya hai. It will occur. Believe in the akhirah or not, like the akhirah or not, try to prevent it or not, your rejection, your disbelief in akhirah will make no difference, because it is the decree of Allah. It is inevitable. Its occurring is certain as something which has already arrived. Allah says, azifa aa chuka hai. It is so certain. So prepare for it, because nothing can stop it. وہ امتحان دینا ہی ہے لَيْسَ لَهَا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ كَاشِفَةً. There is none to avert it. There is none to avert it. In the dunya, you can perhaps pass by. In the dunya, you can live by. But in the hereafter, where will you flee? Where will you run to? You run to the right, left, forward, behind. إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَىٰ. آخر کار. Finally, your destination, your end goal, your end will be your Lord. أَفَمِنْ هَذَا الْحَدِيثِ تَعْجَبُونَ. کیا تمہیں تعجب ہے؟ Are you astonished about this matter? About the warnings, about the يوم الآخرة, about the last day, about the judgment day. Allah says, yet, وَتَضْحَكُونَ وَلَا تَبْكُونَ. تم ہستے اور روتے بھی نہیں. That you laughed instead of crying. Don't be proud of your actions. Repent to Allah. It is the pride in a person which leads a person to reject the truth. And they thought lowly of the Muslims and the believers. So Allah says, وَتَضْحَكُونَ. You laugh, وَلَا تَبْكُونَ. You do not cry. You should be crying of blood, not of tears. وَتَضْحَكُونَ وَلَا تَبْكُونَ. Allah says, وَأَنْتُمْ سَامِدُونَ. You are arrogant. وَأَنْتُمْ سَامِدُونَ. سَامِدُونَ has multiple meanings. One meaning is to lift the head proudly and arrogantly, to be angry, to swell in anger, to sing and dance. So Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would be there, the mushrikeen of Makkah would pass by him with their heads raised up with arrogance and with anger against him. Secondly, because they knew that if we hear the words of Allah, the Quran will be touched, will be affected. So in order not to hear the words of Allah, in order to stop others, they would start singing and dancing and entertain themselves. Allah says, وَتَضْحَكُونَ وَلَا تَبْكُونَ. Is this entertainment? Is this world of sports? Is it entertainment? Is it play? Is it amusement? وَتَضْحَكُونَ. You sing, you dance, you entertain. بس. وَلَا تَبْكُونَ. Will there not be any reckoning? وَأَنْتُمْ سَامِدُونَ. And you are arrogant. After hearing about the powers of Allah, after hearing about how the previous nations were destroyed, about the imminence of the day of judgment, the only course is that submit to Allah. فَسْجُدُوا لِلَّهِ. Bow down to Allah. وَعْبُدُوا. Only worship one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So sajda has become wajib on one who recites this verse or one who listens to this verse. Now to wrap things up, the conclusion of Surah Al-Najm is that وَالنَّجْمِ the star. The star is an adornment in the skies. Likewise, وَهِي is an adornment of the earth. Follow the stars in the skies, you'll be rightly guided to your destination. Follow the wahi of Allah and the words of Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It will lead you into Jannah. Secondly, when people live their lives according to wahi, life in the dunya becomes the paradise for them. Allah will look after their needs in this world and the hereafter. Allah also said, do not look at dunya with desire. Lower your gaze. Look at the akhirah. Because the more you look at the dunya, it will attract zukhruf al-qawl. زُيِّنَ لِلنَّاسِ حُبُّ الشَّهَوَاتِ. The adornment will attract. So focus in the hereafter. We were not created for the dunya. We were not created for our passions. وَمَا تَحْوَى الْأَنْفُسِ. For our desires to be fulfilled in this world. We were not created for the dunya. The dunya was created for us. And we were created for the akhirah. إِلَىٰ رَبِّكَ الْمُنْتَهَىٰ. So that we can meet our Lord finally. Wherein we are pleased with Allah. Allah is pleased with us. So the foundation of iman should be from wahi. إِيَتَّبِعُونَ إِلَّا الظَّنِّ. Do not follow assumptions. Follow only wahi.
Don't worry what people think of you. Worry that what is your position in the sight of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Strive in Allah's path. وَأَن لَيْسَ لِلْإِنسَانِ إِلَّا مَا سَعَى. Anything little or big that you do, Allah values each and every action. If you have akhirat in your mind at all times, then وَتَضْحَكُونَ وَلَا تَبْكُونَ will not happen. In fact, you will weep a lot and laugh less. Hence, Nabi Kareem sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says that visit the graveyard frequently. Why? Because it is the hadimul laddat. It's the destroyer of desires. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to act upon what has been said. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us the ability to recite the Quran, try to understand the Quran, practice the Quran, and share the message of the Quran as well. Ameen wa akhiru da'wana. Alhamdulillah. Rabbil alamin.